characters, and he will share a personal Merl story that few people know.
My name is Jeff Walters, and I'm up here today from Pennsylvania, my first time at ACPT. You all know Merl for his legendary intelligence and creativity and humor. The story I want to share with you now is of another side of Merl, talking to his compassion, his caring, his generosity, and even his sensitivity. I actually never met Merl in person. I didn't have the good fortune many of you did. He and I communicated by phone and email over a period of weeks back in 2009. Okay. So this is about Merl Reagle and the Clara crossword puzzle story. So my wife Clara, on the right there, was diagnosed with melanoma in December of 2008. She died 13 months later in January of 2010. We'd been married for 20 years, and when she passed, my son Matt, in the middle, had just turned 16. The other family member to talk about is Choco the Wonder Dog, right? Remember that name, Choco? But, very important, there's sadness here. But this is a story not about sadness, but about joy and generosity. Clara's form of cancer was rare and aggressive. During 2008, we went through 5 different therapies, radiation, chemo, surgery, the whole works. Throughout it all, very important, Clara insisted that she wanted her life to be about living life, not about the cancer. She was a pediatric nurse, and her coworkers didn't even know she had cancer until chemo treatments meant she could no longer work with sick kids. Many of her friends and neighbors didn't know Clara had cancer until the very end, or in some cases, even afterwards. During this time, I wanted to do something extraordinary for Clara. And in October of 2009, I came up with the idea of surprising her with a Clara-themed crossword puzzle in our local newspaper, which is the Philadelphia Inquirer. Clara and I, full disclosure, were casual crossword puzzle fans, nowhere near the caliber of anybody in this room. I've been participating as a rookie. I think I'm in the 98th percentile at the bottom. Judy, who was sitting next to me, can attest to that. Anyway, but we did enjoy doing the daily crossword puzzle together. And we'd do it in bed before going to sleep. We'd take it to a movie with us and doing it while waiting for the show to start. And between the two of us, and we'd do it together, we could usually complete most or all of the daily crossword puzzle. So I had this idea. I started making calls. And frankly, I hit lots of dead ends. I finally had the good fortune to reach Kevin McCann of Cruciver. And Kevin connected me with Merl, who I literally had never heard of before. I share a situation and my idea with Merl, and Merl immediately, without hesitation, agreed to help me create and place the Clara crossword puzzle. So Kevin and Merl, between them, determined that our local paper, the Philadelphia Inquirer, sourced his daily puzzles from the Los Angeles Times Syndicate. Rich Norris, the Times puzzle editor, agreed to publish Merl's Clara puzzle on December 16th, 2009. I offered to pay Merl whatever he wanted to create the crossword puzzle. And this is true to Merl. Merl said the only compensation he wanted was to hear how it went when Clara did the crossword puzzle. Okay, so Merl and I then worked together to create the Clara crossword puzzle. I sent him relevant names and words and themes. He worked them into the puzzle, sent them back to me, back and forth, back and forth. And then after the puzzle was done, and some of you could appreciate this, we then looked for other words in the puzzle to see if we could create clues relating to Clara. So for example, one word was sedan, and the clue became Ford Taurus, for example. And 1 second. Sorry. Okay, so as Merl described it, by the time we were done, the puzzle was loaded with 19 Clara-related clues and answers, as you'll all see in a moment. Merl spent hours and hours with me on this puzzle, and again, the only compensation he would accept was to hear how it went when Clara did the puzzle. such incredible generosity of both his time and his talents. So, on Wednesday, December 16th, I took Clara to Philadelphia for a morning of infused chemotherapy at Penn's Abramson Cancer Center, and unfortunately a rather difficult meeting with our cancer specialist. When we got home, I suggested that I make us lunch and that we could sit down and do the daily crossword puzzle together. So the first clue was the first name in nursing. And Clara said, Florence Nightingale? That doesn't fit, let's move on. So I said, hang on a second, Florence Nightingale was British. Who was the first American nurse? And Clara said, Clara Barton, B-A-R-T-O-N. That doesn't fit. That doesn't fit either. And I said, but it says first name. And she said, Clara, C-L-A-R-A. That fits, huh? That's the first time I've ever seen my name in a crossword puzzle. Okay, so we continued on. Clara did most of the answers because I wanted this to be her experience, and frankly, I knew the puzzle inside and out. She didn't notice that the answers included her middle name, which is Anne, our married name, which is Walters, her maiden name, which is Clark, my name, which is Jeff, our son's name, Matthew, and our dog's name, Chaco. And you know, when you're doing the daily crossword puzzle, do you really expect it to be all about you? So, the bottom right clue was Lewis or Lois colleague. Okay, five letters. Now the answer is Clark, her maiden name. Lewis and Clark the explorers, Lois Lane and Clark Kent. When Clara got Clark, she said, huh, Clara, all right, Clark. She said, Clara and Clark. What are the odds of that? Then she noticed her middle name, and Anne. Huh, what are the odds of that? You can say it with me if you want to. Sitting on the couch watching this, you know. So, and Walter, huh, what are the odds of that? And she keeps looking around. And Matt, huh, what are the odds of that? And she says, hey, Jeff, I wonder if you're in there. Oh. Yes, Jeff, there you are. Huh, what are the odds of that? And at that point, I couldn't hold back, and I said, yeah, look, and even Chaco's in there. And she said, huh, yeah, hey, wait a minute. It was truly beautiful. And when Claire realized the crossword puzzle in the daily newspaper was about her and for her, she was on cloud nine all day. We then went through and found each of the Claire answers and clues. I'll go through some of them just to kind of give you a flavor. So when Claire was in high school, she loved drama. And she was in the play The Crucible and also starred as Reno Sweeney in the musical Anything Goes. So those were the clues. And those were the answers. About 9 months before, when Claire was diagnosed with cancer, we fulfilled a lifelong wish of hers, which is to go out and see the Rose Parade in Pasadena. We went out early so you can see the floats being built, stayed late so you can get up close to them. Just a couple of pictures. There's Claire and Matt where the floats are being built. And there's the group of us with her brother Woody, who, small footnote, flew in the U.S. Air Force and Air National Guard, including flying F-16s. Again, that will be relevant in a second. So, the clues included the blank parade, and her favorite baseball player, who is the Philly second baseman, Chase Utley. Okay? Philly, you know, he's a good guy. Okay. Going very quickly, one of her child's nicknames was Belle. We used to go skiing, we are family, it's kind of a family togetherness thing, throwing loves in there. And then we also had These are some of the ones where we had a answer that was already in there, and we backtracked a clue to make it fit. So, for example, where your Philadelphia Temple basketball team is the Owls, so the clue for the Owls became Temple basketball team. Just kind of going through, and she just lit up every time she found one more of these. It was really cool. The 40th, and here's kind of a whole, you can get a sense of, when he said it was loaded, 19 separate answers and or clues that related to Clara in some way. So for me, the 45 minutes watching Clara do her crossword puzzle is still the best 45 minutes of my entire life. Okay. There's a little bit more. Okay, so let me touch a little bit on Merle's sensitivity, because that's one of the things that you all may not have had a chance to be exposed to that side of him. As I mentioned earlier, Clara chose not to tell most people she had cancer because she wanted her life to be about life, right? Not about the cancer and the disease. So Merle called me to say that he had a friend who was a reporter at the Philadelphia Inquirer and who was interested in doing a story on this, but only if we were up for it. And he very understood and didn't push back at all when we chose not to do it. Even more so, as you know, some crossword puzzle fans critique puzzles in online discussions the day after they come out. And the day Clara's puzzle came out, some people criticized it for containing so many proper names. And Merle very gently dodged the questions as to why that was the case. And as far as I know, he never told anyone what he had done for me and for Clara. Later that month, Clara wrote to a close friend of hers, and in the letter, she said that her crossword puzzle was the best gift she had ever received in her life. And that best gift would not have happened without Merl Reagle. So in January, the cancer had gone so far along that Clara moved up to hospice care. We were able to do 10 days of the hospice at home, and I got to the point where we had to move her to an inpatient hospice facility. So the ambulance picked her up, transported her in, and she was still awake and alert and all. I stayed behind at home for an hour to straighten up the house, just so things weren't a mess when my son came home from high school. When I got to the hospice, Clara was comfortable and sleeping, but the staff told me that when Clara arrived, she was awake and alert, and as she was settling in, she kept telling all of them about this wonderful crossword puzzle. So Merle's gift of a puzzle to Clara wasn't just a momentary respite for an hour or a day. It was a joyous experience that Clara loved sharing with others, literally right up until the end. There's a bit more. At a college reunion the following summer, I ran into some old friends and told them the crossword puzzle story. At our next five-year reunion, which was last summer, I ran into some of the same people. And to my surprise, classmates came up to me and repeated back the essential parts of the Clara crossword puzzle story, which stunned me, because how often do you remember a story somebody told you at a reunion? Merle's generosity has affected me directly. I realized that I, and frankly all of us, that I had talents and experiences that could really help someone who's navigating a difficult time. And I've tried to become more aware and more open to saying yes in those situations, frankly, as Merle had done for myself and for Clara. So I'm privileged to be here today to share with you the tale of Merl Reagle and Clara's crossword puzzle, to share what a generous and compassionate act Merle did for Clara and for me, and to share the joy that he brought Clara, not only the day she did the crossword, but on every one of the days she had left, even until the very end, and to share how it's continued to touch my life and the lives of others, and perhaps now yours. Will and Patrick and Marie, thank you for including me in today's part of today's tribute to this wonderful, talented, compassionate, and generous man. I think Merle did what many of us hope to do, and perhaps not all of us achieve, which is he made the very most of his talent and his time while he was here, and he touched lives in the most positive of ways. Thank you.
Good to see you all again. I'm just going to come back every year and show video
clips. Thank you very much. I think you all know Patrick Creadon, the director of Wordplay, filmed in 2005, and Keanu was everywhere in 2006. Patrick, I'll just turn it over to you.
All right, thanks so much, Will. How about another round for Jeff? Okay, so I'm looking at my watch. So I have 35 minutes of video, and this is supposed to end in 26 minutes. So I'm not quite sure we're going to be out of here right at 10 o'clock. And by all means, if you have to walk out at a certain time, that's fine. But I just thought it would be nice to fill this room with Merle's voice one more time. I have some clips, some outtakes from our film, some scenes from the movie, and a couple of other things that I thought would be kind of nice to share together. I want to thank Marie for being here. She's down in front, and she was really... Marie had a memorial for Merle in Tampa after he passed away that was amazing. It was absolutely amazing. And this is some of the stuff that we had that day on that celebration. All right, let's see if everything's working. And oh, we should maybe dim the lights. Is that supposed to do that? Yeah, the ones at the side.
Great. I think the ones on the back, but do the...
the very first thing I ever shot with Will, right in this room. Whoopsie. So 1 second. So I need the audio cable. Yeah. I feel like I've known you forever, by the way. We're just meeting. This is kind of cool. Tell me your name and what brings you here this weekend.
My name is Merl Reagle. I'm a crossword constructor. I make the puzzle for several big newspapers in the country. But the reason I come here is because this is where it all happens. This is where, like, all the crossword puzzle people who have been around for years and never had a place to go, come. It's also a chance to meet people I haven't seen for a year, constructors, solvers, who are trying to do better this year than they did last year. We sort of shoot the breeze about what we've been doing lately, because not all of us see everything that each other has been doing all this last year. And little issues have come up during the year, little controversial things have come up. We read about things, but to go to the source, you know, to ask Will a question, to ask the actual constructor a question, to talk about, well, I won't go into it, but to talk about various things that have gone on this year, this is the place. It's like the place where everybody comes together and just, you know, vents or just talks about theme ideas or issues in the puzzle biz. And there's no place like this. There aren't any other ones. This is the one. There used to be lots of them. Now there's one. This is the longest running crossword puzzle tournament in the world. And there's nothing like coming here for a good snowy weekend.
I feel like I've known you for years, is the first thing I said to Merle. And I had known Merle my whole life, I think. I feel like I've known you forever, I think is what I said. But I knew Merle forever, not because I knew Merle Reagle, but because I knew my dad. And if Merle was the perfect puzzle creator in some ways, my father was the absolute perfect puzzle receiver and one who celebrated puzzles. And he loved word games, and he loved puzzles of all kinds, and he loved games. And if it wasn't for that, I would have never endeavored to make Wordplay. I really got that from my father. And my father passed away in May, and Merle passed away in August. And it's, they were two sides of the same coin. And that's what makes tonight even more special for me and for my family who are here. So there's an old saying in the entertainment business, you know, that people can be a tough act to follow. And I think in our business, there may be no tougher act to follow than this guy. and this is a scene from Wordplay, and this is Merle's grand entrance to the movie. And I actually think that Jon Stewart was upstaged by Merle when Merle came on screen. So this is just a couple of minutes from Wordplay.
I respect very much those that create the puzzles. I don't know how they do it. Quite frankly, I don't know why they do it.
Dunkin' Donuts, but at the end of the app, you get unkind donuts.
My name is Merl Reagle. I'm a syndicated crossword puzzle instructor.
Well, Merl is a great guy. We've been friends for years. He's like me in many ways. He was a puzzle head from when he was a child. He started making crosswords when he was in his teens.
Normally, I'm either thinking of puzzles, or cluing them here, or cluing them there, or thinking of themes for puzzles.
Noah's Ark, right there. You switch the S and the H around, that's... No, a shark!
It was part of the day available for me to actually do normal things with the people I love.
Every crossword is a collaboration between the puzzle maker and the editor. I get 60 to 75 puzzles submitted to me every week. So, you know, I go through the mail and pick out the ones that I like best. On average, about half the clues in the Times crossword are my own. I change clues, first of all, for accuracy and as a matter of style, New York Times style. But I'm also making the clues fit the intended level of difficulty. So if I have determined something is a Monday puzzle, I'm gonna try to make all easy clues. And if I've determined this is a Friday or a Saturday puzzle, I'm gonna try to make everything challenging.
When crossword puzzles had begun in 1913, they eventually got so popular that an editor had to be hired to do it every week. Margaret Farrer wanted to do real journalistic things in her life, but she was told, okay, you have to edit the crossword puzzle from now on, which she didn't want to do. So she finally thought, okay, I'll sit down and actually do this. And by doing that, over the course of a couple of years, she standardized puzzles. It's amazing what we still use today from those days. The rule about 1/6 of the diagram can be black squares. The fact that it's all over in a lot, you can't have little islands of words separated from everything else. No two-letter words. Symmetry, the fact that if you turn a crossword puzzle upside down, the arrangement of black squares stays the same. And there's word choice rules. You can't use usually bodily functions in puzzles. You know, urine would bail me out of a corner a million times a year. Same with that. Because it doesn't pass the Sunday morning breakfast test. People saw me on Sunday mornings, the big Sunday puzzle. They waited all week for this. They're sitting there relaxing, and here comes, you know, rectal. First lady of crosswords. When the New York Times decided to start running a crossword puzzle in 1942, she was the one they picked to do it.
When Christine and I first decided to try to make a movie about crossword puzzles, we were really excited. Really, this is gonna be awesome. This is gonna be great. And a colleague of ours pulled us aside once and said, kind of under his breath, "This is the worst idea I've ever had. Think of your children. Do not make this movie. It's going to be a train wreck." So Will said yes, and we dove into this project together. And I said to Will very, very early on, I said, "Will, now, you know, we want to build the story around you, and we're gonna meet some people who are really good at solving, and maybe meet some sort of famous people along the way. But there's some other positions I need to fill. You know, I would love somebody who's a constructor. And then, of course, we're going to need someone maybe who does the play-by-play at the tournament. I'd like to find somebody to help us make a puzzle that'll be in the film on camera. I need to find somebody who, like, knows everybody, who can be, like, the host throughout the film. We need someone who's, like, a really good talker, and we need someone who's, you know, who's, like, really funny." And Will, like, just kind of a long pause, is like, "Yeah, you should probably talk to Merl." He's going to fit in really nicely to all those requirements. So one of the things that I was so, you know, Merl is he's a constructor's constructor. I mean, is that fair to say? Maybe the constructor's constructor in some ways. Maybe it's easier to say that now that he's passed. But he is so good. He was so generous with, turn that off, that's distracting. But he he was so generous with his time, and he was so good at mentoring other constructors along the way. And one of the things that I loved about him were just some of his amazing puzzles. And so when I was interviewing him early on, I asked him about the puzzle, the one that he's most proud of, one of the ones he's most proud of, which is the one with the 21 colors in it. Some of you may be familiar with that. And there's another puzzle he did called Gridlock, which was basically like this giant row of 21 threes across the middle and 21 threes coming, three 21s across the middle, three 21s down the middle, and then more 21s across the top. And it was basically a traffic jam of cars. And this is the longest clip, it's about 7 minutes, but he talks about both those puzzles, and I simply just find it fascinating. So this is Merl sharing his recollections of those two puzzles.
Example of something you've discovered recently.
Yep.
And I'll just pause. One thing that he said, which I always loved, was it wasn't that he made puzzles, it was that he discovered puzzles. That was the thing that I thought was so interesting. He would find puzzles. And then when there were really great puzzles, he was always amazed that no one else had discovered them first. And no one else had seen them, because they're right there, and you know, he would grab them and he'd turn them into something. This is about 7 minutes long, and frankly, it's one of my favorite outtakes, so I hope you enjoy it.
Yeah, this was, John D. MacDonald wrote exactly 21 Travis McGee novels. These are very famous detective novels, where every title has a color in it. The Dreadful Lemon Sky, etc. Well, the fact that he wrote exactly 21 of them is kind of amazing in itself, since most Sunday crosswords are exactly 21 squares wide. However, when I first started looking at this, I tried to make a puzzle out of all the titles. I could never get it to work. So I just took the colors out individually. Lemon, cinnamon, gray, there's 21 colors. Because of the symmetry rule in puzzles where you have to match things up, all the colors matched up exactly symmetrically. There's 2 8-letter ones, there's 2 7-letter ones, there's like 4 6-letter ones, and only one odd one, lavender, I think, or I forget which one. Oh, turquoise is what it was. It was turquoise. Turquoise is 9 letters, went right in the middle. Not only could I put all these colors in this puzzle in a symmetrical way, but you could stack them the whole distance as if it were a trail, and you can go from one to the next as they just stack and curve through the puzzle perfectly symmetrically, as if Travis McGee were on a case tracking something. Now, the fact that all the colors matched up is just an astounding stroke of luck. I mean, the fact that that I managed to look for it, who knows why, but there it was to do. I have no idea why I did this, but it turned out to be superb. So, just one of those things.
Has it run yet?
Yeah, it ran a couple years ago. Got a lot of mail on it.
What do people say when they write?
Well, there was a guy in California that said he wondered how did I even think to think of this? How did I even think to count that there were 21 novels? How did I even think to take the colors out? How did I even think to match them up symmetrically? How did I even think that I was going to luck out that they would match up? And then after, even that they matched up, just putting them throughout the puzzle would have been one thing. But the fact that they can sit on top of each other and form a trail and still form words going down, that's the part where you wonder, why did he even think to do it? And then once he thought to do it, how did he do it? Well, to me, it's just fun. You know, I know this is semi-amazing to some people, but to me, since you were 6 years old, and it's sort of second nature. I'm sure all crossword puzzle people will tell you this, that it seems amazing from the outside. On the inside, our brains naturally work this way. So it's not even amazing to us, it's just sort of what we do.
You like your job?
Yeah. You make your own hours, sit in coffee shops all day, you know. Drink coffee, make puzzles, look out the window, go home.
Well,
Okay, now hold on. I'm going to ask you about another one of your puzzles, okay? Tell me about gridlock.
Well, gridlock, here's another one of these puzzles that I couldn't understand when I thought of it, why none of us in the puzzle business had ever thought of it like 20 years earlier. It's such an obvious idea. Interlocking words, intersections of words. Don't cars and intersections and crossword puzzles all have a lot in common? Calling a puzzle intersection or something like it, you know, because words intersect, cars intersect. So it just was a natural thing. And especially at gridlock, where cars are blocked up at an intersection. So to have like the names of cars going across and down as if they were in an intersection, all bumper to bumper on a really crummy LA day, for example. So they're all stacked up, and how do you put them in there? You can do one line of cars, bumper to bumper, but me, you know, to show off, it has to be three lines of cars, bumper to bumper, and three lines of cars going down. You've got solid white space of cars, you know, Corolla, whatever the names of the cars are, Corolla, Capri, Montego, just nothing but cars, and nothing but cars, and even at the top there's another row of cars and another row of cars at the bottom. It just seemed like a natural thing. Words intersect and interlock, cars intersect, that's why they call them intersections.
When you came up with that idea, did you think you'd be able to pull it off?
Yes, this is something that, if you're, crossword puzzle people are a certain kind of breed. They can sort of look at a situation and know if they can do it or not. We can see a grid, for example, and say, I can probably fill this grid with words. And there are other things that's impossible. No way to do that. But this grid, there are enough models of cars in the world, especially America, that'll have enough names. It was just makes of cars, there aren't enough of those. But you have models, so you can do everything. You can almost, you know, every make of car has tons of models. And it's just a matter of getting them. It's not like having three 21-letter answers going across. That's harder. Here you got little chunks of words. It's actually a lot easier than it sounds. You know, five-letter word, seven-letter word, eight-letter word, and you can change the five-letter word from a Capri to an Omega if you have to. So, and you can do that on three levels. So you can construct this puzzle, taking cars out, putting cars in, so that the words going down will work. Well, that gives you a lot more leeway than just three solid 21-letter answers from the dictionary, for example. You can't take a word out of, you know, let the cat out of the bag. You can't say let the dog out of the bag. That phrase has to stay in. But this way, you can substitute, and going down the same way, you have a lot more leeway. So it was a lot easier to construct than it sounds like. Plus the van thing, I like that too, that angle. The fact that when there was one three-letter word in that was NAV, and that word upside down is van. So what was causing the intersection was this overturned van. That's irritating.
Hear him at the very end. What he said was, you know, we like to do those little things at the end just so people look at it and say, that's irritating. So when we told people that we were going to be making this film, without question, the number one thing people asked us to find out was, how do you make those puzzles? Who are the people that make those puzzles and how do they do it? And so Will and Merle and I came up with a very simple way to have someone make a puzzle in the movie. Merle made a movie called Wordplay, named after the film. And I sat at his and Marie's kitchen table for about maybe 2 hours, and he just built it from scratch in front of me. And I just want to show you a couple of quick outtakes from that. It's funny, I remember my very first day of film school, one of my professors said, never, ever show your raw footage to a large audience. Never. And I'm completely breaking those rules right now. And I think that, truly, I think that Merl can pull it off. Aside from a little bit of camera work moving around, I could listen to Merl talk for days. It's such a pleasure to share this with you guys. Okay, so this is him sort of mid-puzzle, trying to work on some of the details in the Wordplay puzzle that's in the film. It's about 4 minutes.
What else do you have to...
Okay, well, I did this right-hand bottom corner.
What are some of the words down there?
Well, aortas, which is good. Patio. Car, C-A-R-R. Although that copy could be Carl. At grossed going down, but I can just easily be glossed, like glossed over. Could even be flossed. So I got rag, Carl, patio, aortas, lane, sped, and going down, pal, Carol's, rat trap, which I like. Ariadne, which is not great, but I happen to like. I think she's the Greek character that the spiders were named after, because she spun, I think that's right, and glossed, like glossed over. So except for Ariadne, but I think Ariadne is a nice classical mythological word that people should know. You know, we can't just lie down all the time. We gotta sort of try to enrich people a little bit. It's a classic. I mean, I've got Roz in here, I can certainly have Ariadne.
I don't know if you can hear that, because you may not have heard what he said. I mean, you got to class it up a little bit. I mean, I have bras in here.
It just worked out better. I mean, I could probably tear this whole section apart and do a whole different thing in there and get maybe a J or an X or a Q if I really, really tried, but I don't know. It depends. When the whole puzzle is done and I sort of see it, then I might say, well, okay, this corner is so good, and this corner is just so-so, I'll go ahead and rip that so-so corner apart just to sort of bring it up to snuff with the other corner. So, it's a continuous kind of a fine-tuning adjustment sort of a thing.
How do you know when you're done filling, though? What point do you say yes?
Well, deadline was an hour ago, probably. It's that I think that all of the crud is gone. Once all the crud is gone, I basically have a printable puzzle. And when I say crud, I don't mean just obscure words or fragments or abbreviations or things like that. Crud could be the word T-E-L-E, you know, which is a legitimate prefix with television. You know, blank vision, television, telegraph. There's a million words that start with T-E-L-E. It's a word everybody knows, but I just don't like T-E-L-E, for one. It's not, you know, it doesn't... It's just a prefix, and I want real words in there. So there, even though it's gettable and common, I'd rather have just chunky, interesting words. It's hard to describe, but I mean, very often the best words to define, the ones when the cluing time comes, the best words to clue are the ones that are like, that have great possibilities, that don't just have one meaning. You know, you don't want to have A-L-A-I in a puzzle, because the only way to clue it most of the time is hyali, you know, J-A-I blank. Well, A-L-A-I comes up in puzzles all the time, and even though I think it's a mountain range, and even though I think it's something else, hyali is how it's always clued. And how can you clue it? J-A-I blank. Now, you want words like pike, P-I-K-E, got a K in it. Pike can mean a fish, it can mean the turnpike, it could mean that staff that the guys used to hit each other over the head with. Pike, who discovered Pike's Peak. That's the kind of stuff you want. You want a variety of things, a variety of ways to approach a word. And so often, the words we put in there, there's no only one way to approach them. So I would go through and try to make as much of the puzzle as colorful as possible.
Only got about 9 more hours of footage. So. if you knew Merl, and I know a lot of you knew him very, very, very well, he brought so much humanity and humor to conversations that he had with people. He was so funny. He was so warm. He was so supportive. And the thing is, he was really the same way with words. Like, words were like living, breathing things to him. And, you know, there were good words, and there were bad words, and there were crappy words, and there were really colorful words. And, I mean, it was just, for me, it was just fascinating to see him create a puzzle and to talk about the different words and why things were more valuable than others. I just loved it. This is sort of a conclusion. This is kind of a famous scene from the movie, if you know the movie. But this is sort of the raw footage of it, and there's something about this that I absolutely love. And I think maybe one of the things I love most about this is you actually kind of get a peek at Merl and Marie's world, and you kind of see their house, and you see their office, and you see the home that they built together.
Let's see. Let's do trysts. This can't be a you anymore. Red top a word?
Red top.
It's not. No, well then, no, it just work. It just falls into place. This could be jurists or purists. Put a J in there. But this is going to be clay and not clan. I'm going to have the purists. Pens and mute.
Or could red top be like...
Yeah, and CRT is something. That's a...
Opie's other nickname or something? I don't know.
I don't know. I mean, if a red top strikes me as something, I'd have to look. I mean, this is the thing about puzzle people. We know that words exist. We don't necessarily know what they mean until we do know what words exist. I'd have to check it out. This is where the dictionaries would come into play. Then I'd have to sort of look it up and see.
What about, tell me this, what are you thinking about that word red top?
Well, I think it's a word. I think it's a word. I mean, I don't know what it means. It's easy to look up. All I gotta do is scroll in the other room. Sometimes red top is something that actually is kind of interesting. And sometimes it has some incredibly gross meaning that I would never expect. And so I could never, you know, I can't use it. But I'm sitting in here. I mean, in a second, I would go down the room and look it up just to see. And if it were something that's usable or that's actually not so bad, red tip would work too.
Should we look it up?
Yeah, we'll look it up. First, we'll look in the little dictionary, because that's where we want it to be. If it's common enough to be in the little dictionary, then you got something. Red top. A grass grown in the cooler parts of North America for hay, pasturage, and lawns. I'll bet you my lawn guy knows that word.
So, the one thing that Merl said to me more than any other thing in the time that I knew him was, if it wasn't for Marie, none of this would have happened. Because Marie and Merl were the perfect couple. Because Merl had all this talent and really is the first to admit that he wasn't really sure how to corral that. And Marie brilliantly and fearlessly said, we're gonna do this together. We're gonna build a business together. And what I think is so inspiring and impressive about Merl and Marie is that, you know, they were their own thing. They were independent. They made their own puzzles. They edited their own puzzles. They published their puzzles. They had relationships with the booksellers and a website. And you know, they went on, I mean, I think Merl didn't know that they could actually do this and that they could actually build a puzzle, a company on their own. And again, I mean, he told me 100 times, if he told me once, this is all because of Marie. This is all the books that I put out and all the all the deals we have with all the different papers around the country is all because of Marie. And I want to thank you, Marie, for always really fun was when we used to call his house, their house. For a long time, their message said, this is Merle, and Marie is around here somewhere. And then for a while, the same voice would say, this is Marie, and Merle's around here somewhere. And they just had a lot of fun together. And they were a wonderful, wonderful partnership. And in some ways, we have Marie to thank for all the joy that Merle has brought to us, in many ways. Okay, so let me see, let me check. Okay, so this is my last long clip. I have a few more, but this is kind of a long one. And this, in some ways, is Merle's sort of conclusions about what he does. And it's about 6 minutes long.
How is it?
That's okay. I mean, this gar is a word that comes in puzzles all the time. Ite, you know, I would probably retry this in that corner. Because toweled, although there's no M-I-T, I don't think there's an M-E-T-I consonant vowel word. But just to get, like, toweled or boweled isn't a word. But toweled is a busy gal. Gal is a much better word than gar. Even though Terry Garr is quite a gal. Yeah, I mean, as a first run through, it's fine. But I would now go through and just, punch it up.
How long does it normally take you to? How long does it normally take you to make a Sunday puzzle into larger ones?
Let's see, to think of the theme, which is sort of an ongoing process, I probably have like 5 to 7 themes going at the same time. And as I walk around or go around town or drive around, I'm sort of thinking of all 7 of them. And it's often because there's one good theme answer that has no match. I've got a 12-letter theme answer and I don't have another one. And so I just have to keep thinking of ones. I can't think of a 12-letter one generally. I have to just sort of think in general. And then one of them hopefully will be a 12. But then after that, after you got the theme all sort of sitting there, and then you start making the puzzle, I always try to cram in more theme answers than I really should. Will knows better than to do this, by the way. Will encourages people to put in just enough theme answers so that the puzzle, but the crossing words, the downwards, have enough room to breathe. He doesn't want them stacked so close together that the downwards suffer. And he wants that kind of open look, that really breezy look. And I'm very willing to put in more theme answers than I really should, and to let the crossings go where they may. I don't like to, I have a certain limit. I won't cut it down or chop it down or put them so close together that the downs are all 3-letter words. I hate 3-letter words. But I will put in more puzzles, more theme answers than Will. And sometimes the puzzle suffers for it. I know lots of times when I'm making a puzzle, I think, okay, this is a great theme. And when it's all done, I feel like, well, you know, I probably should have left those last 2 out. Yeah. But they're in there and they go. Now, the solver won't know because they're all, it's just a bunch of, the theme is generally pretty good and they're just tootling along and they just solve away and it's fine. But from an aesthetic point of view, I'll sort of moan and groan about it. I mean, it's corny to say that I'm my biggest critic, but I do have some pretty big critics. I like the puzzle. I like I like the black squares to be a certain way. I like the theme to flow a certain way. I like to put like the easiest one first so that people can get a hang of what's going on. And so I don't want to save like an easy one for last. That seems crazy. I want the trickiest, most interesting, or funniest one for last so that they, because most people saw from the top down. I want them to sort of gradually come down to this little climactic bang at the end so that they sort of, so that this last one is, you know, delivers, so that they're solving towards some goal of not just filling the whole thing in, but having the extra value of seeing some other theme thing, something I discovered, something that I, it could be something that I thought, it doesn't matter what it is, but it's something different than the rest of the theme answers, and they're sort of going down the page, heading toward it, and then they finally hit, you know. Of course, I'm not there, but if, when I used to hang out at the cafes in Santa Monica, we used to sit next to people who were solving puzzles, not mine, I mean, but I just watch how they solved it, and the way that they solved it was very interesting. It's just, there's a process where that, you know, if it's a couple, it's like she solves and he just knows a couple of things, or if the other way around. And this process of solving, you know, it's a real interesting thing. People will get wherever they get a foothold in, and the puzzle will progress from there. And won't, some people solve it in like a swarm of locusts going down the puzzle. Some people hit this spot here, spot there. Some people solve in pen, just solve right. You know, they have no crossers at all, but think that this 18-letter word is right. And then when it's wrong, they'll just write over it. And that's the not care thing about it. Solvers are very funny. I mean, I'm just, out there, and there's as many different solving styles probably as there are people. But I just like the whole idea of how the brain works. You know, you watch somebody solve, and you can tell that they're stuck here, and then they sort of, and they hit their head, or then they'll cuss you out, screwy things. But solvers are just great. I mean. The fact that there's actually enough people out there to help us, to let us make a living doing this incredibly nutty thing is just like a dream come true.
Okay, so speaking of amazing significant others, my wife Christine was not able to make it this weekend. She's really sorry she's not here. Something came up last minute back in Los Angeles, and she's with the girls. And but she sends her best. But a few weeks after we shot the tournament in 2005, March 11th, 12th, and 13th of 2005, and about 2.5 weeks later was March 31st, and that happened to be Christine's birthday. And we got this email from her. I'll read it. Dear P, in honor of Nice Shirt's birthday, of course it's Merle, so it's not Christine. In honor of Nice Shirt's birthdays, here's a little 4x4 crossword whose answers use all the letters in Christine O'Malley. Exactly once. Of course, this wouldn't be possible if she didn't have exactly 16 letters in her name. You'll have to draw a little 4x4 grid yourself, number it 1, 2, 3, 4 across the top and 5, 6, 7 down the left side. You know exactly how you would number a regular crossword. Here are the clues. And I'll just read the, it's funny because, I mean, like even like the clues sort of represent sort of who we are. So the across is big family, a clan. We've been accused of having an Irish Catholic clan up here, the Creadon O'Malley clan. Word before mackerel or Moses is holy. Part of the eye or a type of flower is an iris. To portion out as justice is to meet. And then down is start of a song from Mary Poppins. Folk wisdom is lore. Landed softly like a fly or a mosquito. Is a lit and NASDAQ rival whose address is 11 Wall Street, NYSE. It's not exactly the easiest puzzle in the world, he says, but I had to make it kind of fast. So, wish her a happy puzzling birthday for me. You know, that hangs in our office to this day. It just makes us happy every time we see it. So, of course, when my dad saw that, his head almost exploded. He just couldn't even get around how amazing that was. So they were forwarding it, you know, my parents and our siblings were forwarding it to everybody and we were printing them and sending them to relatives back in Ireland. And it was like this amazing thing that he had done, and that Merl had done. And of course, my father loved it more than anybody. And it's amazing because the thing about Merl that I think it's easy to forget is Merl was a great artist. And so when you think of like singers or performers, don't start crying, Evie, because you're going to get me crying. When you think of people who act really well or can juggle or anything, whatever it is that they're really amazing at, people gather around them. You know, they want to be around the glow of that talent and that joy. And Merl was like that, like no one I ever knew. Just amazing. So of course, the puzzle that he ended up making, which is in Wordplay, we had quite an interesting group of people to gather around to solve that puzzle. Jeff, are you there for your one task that I was hoping you could help me with? You know, in the movie, right in the middle of the movie, Merl had made the Wordplay puzzle. He submitted it to Will. Will accepted the puzzle. I think Will may have felt pressure to accept it because I was filming him as he was, you know, judging the puzzle, but he ran it. And this is the scene in the movie.
I gotta find it. Puzzles didn't have that. My feeling was crosswords should have everything that's being covered in the Times. And of course, that's going to be classical music and art and history and old subjects like that. But it includes sports, popular music, movies, TV, cartoons, everything.
Why, there it is.
One thing you have to do is just get rid of the rest of the paper when you do this. It's not important in your life anymore.
Find the hidden H where it's hiding. Is it on the ground or in the sky? Or
they always fold it over. You have to fold it over.
I gotta tell you, I was gonna do it in pencil, but it's Tuesday. Yeah, that's right. What do you think of that?
Some people make our band members use pencils, I've noticed. Why do we do that? Because we don't trust them.
Very bravely, I'm a pen guy, actually. It comes back to haunt you once in a while.
All right, here we go.
You know what? I'm so confident, I'm going to do it with glue sticks.
First answer, and his clue is warhead weapon briefly. Seems all right.
Warhead weapon briefly? It's got to be ICBM, come on. Everybody goes for that.
Warhead weapon. Got to be an ICBM or a murder. Got to be ICBM.
Probably Norma Ray. R-A-E.
She helped Theseus escape the labyrinth.
Okay. East northeast is 737 heading, perhaps, and he's abbreviated, perhaps.
East, north. East.
East, northeast.
This is the standard crossword position.
They were on Sunday Star, Molina Mercury, it had to be oval, I kind of never remember.
You lean back and put it on your knee. So,
main arteries? How can that not be main arteries? How can it not? No, it's not.
Cross swords to duel with, yes.
Duel with. Cross swords. And wait, duel with is cross swords, which is also cross words. So they're playing with us here. That's wonderful.
Duel cross swords. See what you've done here, Will, if I may. The triple S. You think that's cute? That's not cute.
Yeah, the wordplay. Not too hard, but it's very clever. And there's the word play or the word word and all the big clues like Playa del Rey. That's what's going on here.
Now wait a minute, what the?
Can you find them? Here they are.
Okay, a little play for you. Is Dan Okren in the room right now? He went up, okay. That's okay, I'm still gonna ask. Why does Dan Okren not appear in that montage? Only at the beginning and the end. Because he's working on his times. He was racing his way through the puzzle and he didn't talk to me while he's doing it. Okay, that's going real deep. Okay, so we're almost done. You'll be out of here in 7 minutes, I promise. So let the people in the bar know. So we finished the movie, we submitted it to Sundance, we got into Sundance, we sold it there. I mean, it was just this unbelievable run with our little film that we made in our spare bedroom in Los Angeles. It was a dream come true for us. And then like a year after the movie got finished, something happened that like topped everything else. I mean, it was like just when we thought it couldn't get any better, this happened.
Dad, I know this is crazy, but did you find a message to me in the New York Times crossword puzzle?
Well, I had a little help from this guy.
Dr. Will Shorts! The master puzzle is Dr. Merl Reagle!
I wrote that crossword, and I edited it. Now get back to crosswording.
Yes, sir.
Kind of touch. Dumb dad, sorry for his bed. Nice.
You didn't get Homer's whole message, Lisa.
I didn't?
Take a look at the first letters of all the clues.
Dear Lisa, you make me so happy. Really, really, really happy. Sorry, you told me I needed 144 letters. What was that point again? All right. To be your Simpson, I cherish you.
Oh, Dad.
So one of the people we interviewed said that he talked about how much he loved crosswords, but that he felt like they were like skywriting. Because you'd spend all this time with them, but then they'd be gone. They'd just kind of be gone. You'd throw them in the garbage, they'd be, there's some truth to that, obviously. But there's also an incredible connection between great constructors and great editors and people who love crosswords. And I think that connection will last forever. And I think that Merl and his work are going to last forever. I really believe that, in large part because Marie is going to be around forever. But just to prove my point, remember that puzzle that Merl did for Christine? Well, my dad loved it so much that he decided to turn it into a piece of jewelry. With a little star in the middle, little diamond. And very few things explain why crosswords are so special than that little pendant that my dad made for Christine and that Merl created. And it's a great reminder of why this is such a special place and why Merl is such a special guy. The last thing I want to show you is a clip that you probably, many of you have seen before, and that's okay. Jeff, can I get your help one more time? Okay, thanks. I want to leave on this note, because I think this is really, more than anything, what our movie was about. So thanks so much for coming out tonight, guys.
Next performer is our double act, the Hill Sallys.
Year. And they look the same. I mean, you know them. They look the same from year to year. And then I suddenly realize I've known these people for 27 years. Some of them, they've changed. So have I. But you don't see the change from year to year. This is hard to say. In 1981, I lost my husband. And it was on Sunday afternoon here, right after the competition. He had a heart attack. Some people said, you know, it's not hard to come back here. But he wanted me to do it. He was very proud of the fact that I had won. And in his memory, I would not stop coming back. But it's a little bit hard for me to walk out in front of the front door there. I like to go out the other way. And I can still picture him coming through the door. There are people who we've lost who aren't back. And the place is haunted. I can still see faces. I can still see people here who are no longer here. Not enough of us are kind of haunting that in that respect.
Home is where I want to be. Pick me up, enter me. I come home. I'm born with a weak heart. I guess I must be.
Round tomorrow, round 7, puzzle 7 is at 9 o'clock. So I'll see you all. Have a good night.